for the recess, the Republican Study Committee, which speaks for 80% of House Republicans, unveiled a blueprint for a total Republican control, including the White House. The contrast between their vision and House Democrats could not be more stark. House Republicans want to cut Social Security and Medicare, and Democrats want to protect these programs. House Republicans want to end IVF. We want to protect Americans to start their and grow their families. Their budget is a foundational document, and their goal is to ban abortion. House Democrats will never stop fighting to restore reproductive freedom. House Republicans want to take health care away from millions of Americans and have drastic cuts to Medicaid and the Affordable Care Act. House Democrats want to protect the ACA and lower the cost of insurance and prescription drugs. Their budget will raise energy costs and housing costs at a time when Americans are struggling to make ends meet. House Democrats passed a tax cut that would lower utility bills and are working to make homeownership more affordable. House Democrats fought to bring back jobs from overseas and to invest in America, while their budget will reverse those gains by cutting the Inflation Reduction Act. We will always stand against these extreme policies and put people over politics. With that, introduce the Vice Chair, Ted Lieu.
Thank you, Chairman Aguilar. I want to start with a correction. At the press conference before recess, I said that 70% of Republicans are in the Republican study group. It's actually 80%, as Chairman Aguilar had noted. And that's important because the budget that they release is insane. It is going to cut Social Security. It's going to eliminate Medicare as we know it. And it's going to eliminate the Affordable Care Act. By the way, I am on Obamacare. And let me tell you why the Affordable Care Act is so important. It doesn't just apply to people who have it. It applies some of the provisions to every insurance plan. One of those provisions is provision preventing insurance companies from discriminating against you if you have a pre-existing condition. So I'm gonna tell you a story. When I was in the California State Legislature, this was before Obamacare had been passed. I was sitting at a restaurant and this waitress knew I was in the legislature and she came up to me and she asked for help. At that time, if you did not have a child who was a minor, you could not get government-assisted health insurance. Her child just turned 18, and she aged out of that program. So this waitress said that she had been diagnosed recently with breast cancer. She tried to get insurance. Insurance companies denied her because it was a pre-existing condition. And it became clear to me that she wasn't sick enough to go to an emergency room to get treated. But one day she was gonna get sick enough, go to the emergency room, get treated, and then she was gonna die. And in my mind, in a country like America, that should never happen. The Affordable Care Act fixed that. And Republicans now wanna eliminate the pre-existing conditions provision. That is insane. And now it's my honor to introduce our amazing DCCC chairwoman, the great Susan DelBene.
Thank you, Vice Chair Lieu and Chair Aguilar. We just finished up a great caucus meeting down the street where there was lots of energy and enthusiasm in the room for our shared work to take back the House majority in just 7 months. I travel all around the country and Americans constantly tell me that they want to see governance work. They want lawmakers to come together to solve the problems that they're facing. But under a Republican majority, we've seen nothing but chaos and extremism since day one of this Congress. The American people are fed up with the nonsense that doesn't help them in any way. On any significant legislation that has actually become law this Congress, it has been bipartisan and passed with Democratic votes in the House. Leader Jeffries and Democrats have always said we will support bipartisan solutions and stand up against extremism. Nowhere is it Republican extremism more apparent than with reproductive rights. In this Congress alone, House Republicans have passed 4 bills that would restrict access to reproductive care and introduced an additional 6 anti-abortion bills, including 2 national abortion bans. Republicans contend that the unpopularity of their extreme anti-abortion position is simply a messaging problem, not a policy problem, that if they just talk more about it, then they'll be fine. But let's be clear about what the consequences are of what they're talking about. These bills would outlaw IVF, criminalize doctors for providing critical health care, block reproductive care for our service members, and restrict access to mifepristone nationwide. Their extreme policies have very real, dangerous impacts for millions of women across the country, endangering their lives and their well-being. The evidence is clear. Republicans are on the wrong side of public opinion. Since the Dobbs decision, the American people have protected reproductive freedoms in 7 straight state referendums. They are turning out to defend their rights, and this November, at least 7 more states will likely have abortion measures before the people. In these states are 18 swing districts that will be critical to determining the House majority, and reproductive freedom is guaranteed to be a driving issue. The simple truth is, when abortion rights are on the ballot, people turn out to defend their rights, and Democrats win. Only Democrats support women's right to make their own health care decisions, period. Republicans are simply too extreme for everyday Americans and aren't focused on the priorities of working families. This is the contrast that we're going to continue to highlight here in Congress and back in our communities from now through November. Thank you. And now I want to turn it over to the gentleman from Arizona, our great colleague, Congressman Greg Stanton.
Thank you very much, Chair DelBene and Chairman Aguilar and Vice Chair Liu, for your leadership. Yesterday was a dark day in my home state of Arizona. Our state Supreme Court reimposed a near total abortion ban, a law from 1864, before women could vote in the state of Arizona, before Arizona was even a state. It is one of the most restrictive bans in the country, with absolutely no exceptions for rape or incest. As devastating as this ruling is, it is not surprising. This outcome is exactly what Donald Trump and MAGA Republicans intended when they worked to overturn Roe. And if they think the safe, politically expedient stance on abortion is, we'll let the states decide, this is the result. Last night, I was on the phone with a doctor, an abortion provider, back home in Maricopa County. She said, women will die because of this decision. Her patients are calling her clinic panicking. And she said even planned pregnancies that become high risk will be affected. A constituent of mine, a bright young engineer, wrote to me just last night saying that she no longer feels safe trying to start a family in Arizona. She's terrified that if something were to go wrong, her doctors wouldn't be able to give her the care she would need. We are at an inflection point in this country. And I know I speak for my colleagues here when I say we will not sit by and watch our fundamental freedoms be stripped from us. This November, in Arizona, safe and legal abortion access will be on the ballot. And people won't walk. They will run to the polls in Arizona. And they'll come out in force to elect candidates who truly, consistently, and sincerely support abortion rights at every level of government, especially here in Congress. We have some of the most competitive congressional seats in the country in Arizona. And right now, the same politicians who co-sponsored the Life at Conception Act to end all abortion and celebrated the Dobbs decision are trying to distance themselves from the Arizona Supreme Court ruling. The American people are smart. They know when politicians are talking out of both sides of their mouth. When Democrats take back the House, and we will, we're going to take women's rights in this country forward, not backward. We're going to protect access to IVF and contraception. We're going to pass the Women's Health Protection Act and restore Roe as the law of the land. I'll hand it back to Chair Aguilar for questions.
Thank you, Representative Stanton. Questions? Allie?
Questions about how Johnson's going to bring this up, what it's going to look like. Over the weekend, though, one of your members told me that there were a lot of Democrats who would save Johnson's job if MTG dismissed him. should they get a vote on Ukraine aid? What are the conversations in the caucus around Ukraine aid and saving Johnson's job if it comes to that?
Look, our position has been incredibly clear. Ukraine needs the help and assistance in order to protect their democracy and prevent Vladimir Putin from his continued aggression. We need to deliver aid as quickly and as timely as we can. The Senate bill, that bipartisan bill 70 senators signed on to, is the quickest and fastest way to do that. That's the bill that we need to put on the floor. That's the bill that we need to pass and send directly to the president. We have implored and we have asked. You've heard me say it from here a number of times that we need to pass that. The speaker needs to put that bill on the floor. You have also heard me say, you've also heard Leader Jeffries say, and he has pointed out that it was an observation, not a declaration, that we feel if the speaker does the right thing, that he is in a good position. But look, we've got to do the right thing. We've got to pass these bills. We've got to have some sanity under this dome. And that means putting bills on the floor that have 300 votes. That's our hope. That's what we want to happen. That is our encouragement to the speaker. To my knowledge, there's not been any conversation among him and our members. But look, our members want to govern. Every day, House Democrats wake up and we want to try to get to yes on bills. We want to try to help our communities. We want to support good pieces of legislation. We don't like this circus and this chaos that House Republicans seem to be comfortable with. It's in that spirit and that hope that we hope that they continue and that they advance legislation to help people in Ukraine.
During the district work period, Donald Trump posted that he shouldn't jail the January 6th committee members. I suspect you don't want to be jailed. How do you react to that? What do you make of that? And how do you prepare for that eventuality?
Yeah, I mean, normally I poke some fun normally I would probably say some other things, but this is just deeply dangerous rhetoric that the former president has advanced. Consistent thoughts and advocacy to jail his opponents, from Liz Cheney to the January 6th committee to others. I mean, he wants to act like those dictators that he hosts, that he talks to on the phone and that he hosts in Mar-a-Lago. That's difficult rhetoric, and it's not anything that any of us, any of the members under this dome take lightly. But specifically, the January 6th committee members, we understand that we had a job to do. Our job was to chase every fact and to do everything we could to uncover the truth of what happened on January 6th. We feel that we did good work, and we're willing to take those consequences. And generally, whether that's the House Administration Committee trying to employ revisionist history over that day, or whether that's the former president and his rhetoric, I won't tell you all of the conversations, but these are conversations that members have, and it's not anything that we take lightly. But my family has told me that they're going to come to D.C. either way and visit me, no matter where I am.
Sir.
Anybody else have? Go ahead.
Well, follow up on Ukraine, just to clarify, there are a lot of conversations that if there are going to be motion to vacate Speaker, Democrats might save him in exchange of him bringing aid to Ukraine on the floor. Is there any conversations of such sort of, and is it a thing right now that are discussed in the Democratic caucus?
No, look, if the speaker wants to have a conversation with Leader Jeffries about that, that is where the discussion should be had. Members want to see the speaker do the right thing. House Democratic members want to see the speaker put this bill on the floor so we can send it to the president's desk so we can deliver the important aid to Ukraine. That's what we want done.
Sure. On the foreign and soldier.
Nathan,
okay. I want to ask about the FISA bill that's coming up. The rule today looks like it could fail with Republicans voting against it. What does this say about the way the House is being run right now? And is there a world in which Democrats would help on any of these rules
on bills that, in theory, members of the party could support.
We have said clearly, you know, we have to reauthorize FISA. Unfortunately, the speaker has chosen to couple this rule vote with a bunch of other things, and has chosen he's made that choice. So whatever the vote count is, or whatever happens to that, it's because the speaker has chosen not to advance this issue in a single standalone process. If he chooses to go a different route, then we'll reassess. But right now, the rule vote is very clear. It has partisan, resolutions attached to it, and so I would not anticipate any Democrats supporting it. We understand the importance of reauthorizing FISA and protecting our national security. We want that. Unfortunately, the speaker has chosen to play politics and to try to boost his vote count on his side by adding these other measures. I'll yield to the vice.
Along those lines, what exactly would have to change for Democrats to want to save that? And what do you make of Trump calling on House Republicans to kill it?
Specifically on FISA?
Yeah.
Or, look, I think that there's, and we've seen, I want to be very clear, there's been divisions even within Judiciary Committee members and Intelligence Committee members on both sides. If the Speaker wanted to have a real conversation about this issue and advance this as a standalone issue and let members vote where they may, that is not the place we are in. The Speaker has chosen to pair FISA, which we all acknowledge needs to be done, with partisan measures that will make it difficult for Democrats to endorse. And so, you know, we're not planning, unless this rule passes, then we will have an opportunity to debate the amendments that were ruled in order, and members can vote how they're going to vote. But specific to the rule, the Speaker has chosen this path. He has made this a partisan exercise, and so House Democrats aren't going to go along with it. Anybody else on FISA?
Oh.
In the back. Yeah.
How do you plan on, if the rule does pass, how do you plan on voting for a warrant requirement? Would you vote in favor of adding a warrant requirement for Section 702?
We're going to have a bipartisan classified briefing later this afternoon. I'll be presiding, I believe, with Mario Diaz-Balart on the Republican side, hearing from our national security individuals. And I'll take all of that in, like most members, read the material again. I read FISA 1.0 and FISA 2.0. This is 3.0 that we're in. I'll continue to read the documents, and I don't have anything to offer on that at this point. Max.
Do you have any update or any reaction to Tom Cole being the new Appropriations Chair? I know you're an appropriator. And then a follow-up on that, any new updates on the Baltimore Bridge rebuilding effort and what House Democrats are doing to get that package repaired?
Yeah. The second part first, I haven't heard anything specific to within that role, the Transportation Housing Appropriations Committee member. We have not huddled on this issue. We understand the thoughts. We understand the position of the Maryland delegation. We've taken in what the administration has said with Secretary Buttigieg. Also, you know, need to say our hearts as a Democratic caucus go out to those construction workers who lost their lives and their family members who are dealing with that now. Specific to the dollar amounts of who pays and how that happens, I'll leave that to the administration and working with us. I know Secretary Buttigieg has said that he wants the taxpayers made whole. So that's all part of the conversation that I'm sure we'll have over the next few weeks leading into this FY25 budget cycle as well. I just left an appropriations meeting, and the last thing I did as I was walking in the door, I walked over to Chairman Cole and told him congratulations. I look forward to working with him. I've always enjoyed working with Tom Cole, even when we disagree a lot. And he's just a kind and decent person. Pleased to see him holding the gavel in that committee, and look forward to working with him.
Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The March CPI was released
This morning, inflation came in a little hotter than expected. Rent, car insurance, home health care, a lot of the kitchen table issues that Democrats focus on came in, you know, a little higher than expectations. I want to know what your message is to Americans out there who hear the message of, you know, the jobs being created, wages up, a lot of the macroeconomic indicators, but may not be feeling it because of these kitchen table costs. What's your message to Americans out there?
The Democrats stand ready to work to lower the costs that everyday Americans face. The burdens from housing affordability to childcare prescription drugs. We are the group who is advocating for proposals to lower those costs. And if given the opportunity to lead in this chamber, those are the policies that we're going to advocate. But it's not lost on us, and I appreciate the question, that, you know, oftentimes we talk 15 million jobs, rebuilding bridges, roads, all of these things, incredibly helpful, because that all takes people who are performing the work and lifting up those employees and those jobs that are created. But to everyday Americans who are just going around, you know, their districts in California and Arizona and Washington, taking their kids to school, going to church, going to work, we know that they're feeling that concern. We know that they're feeling pinched, you know, post-pandemic, that it's difficult. And we stand ready to work to lower those costs and lower those burdens that they face. And we're the only ones who have policies that will actually do that. I'll yield briefly to the vice chair and then the chairwoman as well on this, because it's so important.
Thank you, Chairman Aguilar. Jobs are up. GDP growth is up. Wages are up. You know what else is up? Corporate profits. And what we see are a number of corporations now price gouging consumers. So when Democrats were in control, we were able to pass a law to lower the cost of insulin to $35 a month instead of hundreds of dollars. Did the drug companies voluntarily lower insulin? No, we had to pass a law to force them to do so. You give Democrats control again, and we're going to pass more laws to make sure there's no price gouging of consumers.
You know, I started out talking about that folks want to see governance work. And part of governance working is making sure that we have folks who are actually going to see the issues that are facing the American people and help move us forward. And all we've seen from this Congress, from the Republican majority, is chaos, dysfunction, and extremism, no focus at all on actually moving forward policies to help the American people. In fact, many of the policies that we see that are helping right now are policies we passed when we had President Biden and a majority in the House and were able to pass critically important legislation. So we have the plans, and we have and are talking to the American people. What we need is folks to govern, and I think people understand that. They see the chaos and dysfunction. They know that Democrats want to actually move our country forward and address issues. We're happy to talk about policy, not just put forward messaging bills that are going nowhere. And I think that has a big impact on people all across the country.
One other thing that will have an impact to people all across the country, the chairwoman has led these efforts with my chairwoman, Rosa DeLauro, is the child tax credit. There's a proposal right now that would deliver help and assistance to families directly. House Democrats overwhelmingly supported that. We hope the Senate takes it up. And that's something that we can do if we govern. And that's what you've heard us say. Last question.
Can you give any updates on efforts to provide aid to Haiti?
It's a good question. I don't have any latest updates from the discussions. I know that Chairman McCall was having those conversations before the break, that he had some concerns about that. I think that's a question for House Republican leadership and Chairman McCall. As to what the next steps are and whether he's willing to sign off on aid and assistance. There may be other packages that have to proceed, but the fastest way is to unlock that funding that could go directly to Haiti right now on the security side. And then we have much more conversations on the economic side, clearly. But to stabilize where we are in the country, we need security assistance. And for that, we need Chairman McCaul to sign off. Thank you.